Welcome to Tom Libous Reports to You.
We help our kids succeed by encouraging them to read and stay off drugs and alcohol. Our roads and bridges have to be safe when our families travel. It's our responsibility to make sure that everyone succeeds.
Watching Tom Libous Reports to You. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, the senator and I are going to talk about the life of Senator Tom Libous in Albany.
That might be pretty boring, Julia.
No, I've looked through the list of day-to-day activities. It's not boring.
It's certainly been pretty busy. There's no question about it.
Yeah, so we're going to take a look at last Tuesday.
Okay.
And, you know, it's a pretty typical day in Albany for you. Before we go through step by step, tell us, what is it like?
Well, first off, we start off right now this time of year with budget briefings and budget information before we start meeting with the groups, and we're going to go through all of the groups that we meet with. And, you know, sometimes the meetings are 10 minutes, sometimes they're 15 minutes, but when you're meeting with 15, 20 different groups, you have to go to conference. Now, conference, to those people who are watching this program, is meeting the Republicans get together and we get briefings on budget bills and different legislation, and so that's what we call conference. I know most people back home have no clue to what conference is, but these are the kinds of things that we do in the day. Believe me, it starts at 7, usually at 7, and before you know it, it's 10 o'clock at night.
So right now, you say you meet with groups throughout the day.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us what their concerns are right now.
Oh, everything from budget. You know, we lost money in the budget. Most people are starting to get and understand that there is no money, that the state is broke. And right now we're just trying to convince them that the best thing we can do is get an on-time budget so that we can move forward and make some very tough decisions. Some of the groups don't like it. They don't want to accept it. Others are pretty fair-minded, and they get it.
Right. So do you have the sense that people feel like they are getting treated fairly?
We try to treat everybody fairly. Some people get pretty mean and nasty. Last week here in Albany, 17 people were arrested on the first floor of the Capitol. I can remember I had like a 5-minute break, and I wanted to come down to the cafeteria and get a cup of coffee. And my staff said, "Boss, you can't go down there. The state police have it all, roped off, fenced off, and they're arresting people." So people misbehave.
Right, yeah, those protests.
They misbehave.
Outrageous.
People should be able to protest. So we have no problem with that. But don't misbehave. They were blocking entrances, pushing people around. That's over the line. You can protest, but don't misbehave.
Right. Okay, so let's run through your day. You got into the office about 8 o'clock,
mm-hmm.
and headed to a 4-H breakfast.
I went to a 4-H breakfast. We've got some pictures here. We met with various 4-H young people from, I believe, Broome in Tioga Counties. And as we talked about earlier, there's a couple shots that were shown for the breakfast. But 4-H stands for Head, Heart, Hands, and Health. And it's a great organization that has been going on for a long, long time. And these young people, many of them are very interested in agriculture, obviously, and have grown up on farms or want to continue some sort of farming. And they're learning the high-tech side of 4-H. You know, farming isn't just learning how to farm the land and milk a cow by hand or what have you. This farming today is high-tech farming. It's it requires a lot of schooling and degrees, and the 4-H is a great organization, great people in it.
Right, and agriculture is the number one industry in New York.
Agriculture is the number one industry, and we need to continue to keep it, particularly in upstate New York, a number one industry.
Right, and so positive values, and also it aims to make public schooling more relevant.
Public schooling more relevant. This is their, I believe it's their 100th anniversary. I hope I'm not wrong in saying that, and it was great to see the kids.
Okay, so 9 o'clock. You had a confirmation hearing. Tell us about that.
Confirmation hearing. Now, let me explain to everybody what a confirmation hearing is. The governor sends us the name of somebody that he wants to confirm. This is a hearing room that we're in. You can barely see me, but you'll hear my voice, I think, in this, or there's a picture at least. There I am at the hearing waiting for Joe Martins, the DEC commissioner. This is Mr. Martins. He's the DEC commissioner, and or he soon will be the DEC commissioner. And I was asking him questions about natural gas drilling at the time. So that was right after the 4-H breakfast, and that went on for some time. And I was already late for my next meeting before the confirmation hearing could be over. But it was important that I ask him those specific questions that deal with natural gas drilling and brownfields. If he is going to be the DEC commissioner, we have to make sure that he wants to move forward on natural gas drilling.
Right, decisions that are important for New York and specifically your district.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay, so you get back to your office, and at 10 o'clock, you jump right into more meetings. First, you met with some people from your district who represent Supportive Housing Network.
This is Supportive Housing Network. These are folks that are from a district. Actually, the young lady straight ahead is my niece, who actually works for the YWCA. And she was here with the YWCA and a number of folks who provide supportive housing for many people with mental illness and folks who can't get housing, folks who would normally be homeless. And, you know, we've done a good job over the years taking homeless people off the street. And this group, the YWCA and other supportive housing groups, do a very good job. So we had a good meeting with them, and we talked about a whole host of issues. Obviously, one of their concerns was that the governor's budget was cutting them substantially, and they were concerned as to how they would proceed.
Right, and there are the Supportive Housing Network, I understand, currently represents 180 nonprofit organizations.
180 nonprofit organizations, so they are well spread out throughout the state, and certainly nonprofit organizations, Julie, as you know, they get their funding and their money from the state of New York, and so it hurts them dramatically when things don't come together.
Okay. Then the next step is 10:30. You met with superintendents from your district?
I met with superintendents. There I am bending over the table, as agile as I am, folks from the district. These are all superintendents. We're now sitting down. If I could just, let's see, if you're going around the table from left to right, I'm thinking Susquehanna Valley, Union Endicott, Oxford, and Windsor. And we're looking at, with the exception of UE, the rural school district budgets to see exactly where they're falling out. We know that there's a problem this year in the governor's budget. School aid is cut, but there's a severe problem with rural school budgets. And we're hoping we can help offset some of that. Probably one of the biggest problems is that enrollment is dropping. And in New York State, school aid is distributed by the number of pupils in a district. So if the enrollment is dropping, that means they're going to get less aid.
Right. And mandate relief, that's a big issue.
Mandate relief is a huge issue. And just to talk about that for a second, you know, the governor's committee came back with a report, and unfortunately there was nothing exciting in it. Same old stuff, and it's concerning.
Right. So the Senate actually passed a moratorium on all unfunded state mandates in January, right?
Yes, we did. And we do that frequently. When we were in control a couple years ago, we did it. We did it again in January. We passed the property tax cap bill because we believe property taxes are too high. But we also said that you have to have something to deal with unfunded mandates because you can't keep sending mandates that cost local school districts and local districts taxpayers, particularly in towns and villages, you know, all these costs that they can't deal with.
Right. So tell us what it does for a school district or a local government when they have mandates that they just can't afford.
Well, it costs them additional money. I mean, particularly there's a variety of mandates right now that deal with pension costs and other things. And, you know, we're trying to do everything we can. We're looking at every mandate as it pertains to the school district. But let me tell you what the problem is. The Board of Regents is a major problem. You know, many people think that we in the legislature impose mandates that are unfunded. The Board of Regents imposes most of the mandates, and then they come to us, the legislature, and say, this is going to cost $15 billion or $15 million. You know, that's not right. So the Board of Regents creates a lot of the unfunded mandates on school districts.
Okay. So moving right along, now we're going to go just 3 hours into your day at this
That's
point.
All, just 3 hours.
Yeah. 11 o'clock you met with the Farm Bureau, so Broom.
And there we are. I'm there with Harvey's a good friend of mine from Coventry, and you know, he wore his hat in, so I just wanted him to know that he wasn't alone. And Those who see me on this show with no hair on my head in the wintertime, I need that hat. So we thought we'd take a nice picture together. We've known each other for over 20 years, and he's been active on the board in Coventry and worked very hard for the Farm Bureau. So we just had a little fun, little light fun before the meeting.
Right. So I understand that New York's farm economy generated $4.7 billion in tax receipts in 2009.
It did, and farming is, as we said, agriculture, very important in my district, Broome-Tioga and Chenango County, and, you know, we work with them on a regular basis and try to move things forward. And the Farm Bureau was founded in Broome County. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
I was told that. I hope they're right, but they told me the Farm Bureau was founded in Broome County. This is their 100th anniversary, and I think it's pretty neat.
Right. And so with that $4.7 billion, they want some of that to come back to them.
Of course they do. Of course they do. I mean, that's a lot of money that's produced. They want it to come back to them, and it should come back to them.
Right. So, okay, 11:30. You went to the convention center.
I went to the convention center at 11:30
and spoke with the
American Federation of Labor. There's a whole group of state, local, about 2,000 people. We don't have a picture of it, but I followed Comptroller DiNapoli, who was speaking. I was speaking on behalf of the Senate. So I got up and I revved them up and told them to be passionate when they go meet with their legislators. Don't be mean. Don't be nasty, because people can't get anything with mean and nasty. That it's better that if you be open-minded and have a passionate discussion as to what you believe in.
Very good advice.
It was good advice.
Okay, what are we? 12:30.
12:30. We're still. It's not even lunchtime yet. By the way, that's unheard of. Lunch. It's just doesn't happen.
Yeah, it's not in the schedule.
No, it doesn't
I can see
happen.
That. Yeah.
Binghamton University Advocacy Day, which we're very proud of. Binghamton University. I'm here with Jim Dix, who is the United University Professionals representative for the union, represents all of the professors at Binghamton University. Jim's a great guy. I've known him for a number of years, and works very hard on behalf of the professors at Binghamton University. So we had a day where we talked about Binghamton. Here's some other folks from Binghamton. You can see the display where we promote Binghamton University here in the state capitol, and that's something that I think is extremely important.
Right, so there's some new ideas for the future of Binghamton.
New ideas for the future, new things that we want to do. You know, we've worked in the health science, we've worked in the natural sciences, we've worked in computer chips, and now we're looking to get more into the health and natural sciences. If we can partner up with Upstate Medical, I think it could bring a lot of jobs to the southern tier.
Right, and they, like a lot of other people you met with this day and every day, really, right now, looking for their fair share of the budget.
Everybody's looking for their fair share, but everybody understands that fair has a different meaning today than it might have a few years ago when the economy was good.
Right, so again, you met with, this is at 1:30.
The local AskMe people, sure. Right. These are my local reps. They came to see me at 1:30. I spoke to the whole group statewide, then the local reps came in at 1:30. And we met with them. They talked about their issues. Actually, most of them were from Binghamton University. They shared some things with me. And then after that, at 2 o'clock, I had to go to conference. And I'll repeat again, this is a meeting of the Republicans behind closed doors where we get briefed on budget issues and legislation that's going to come to the floor that day. And as you know, I run the floor, which is shortly thereafter at 3 o'clock. And I think we might have some pictures of that where I'm actually running the floor for the Senate, moving things along. There I am actually on the Senate floor. My job as the Deputy Majority Leader is to make sure that the floor is run smoothly, and we can get into that probably more at another time.
Right. Okay, so last week was a busy week for you as a whole. So
crazy.
Let's just run through the different people that you met with really quickly.
We're going to show them on the screen. These are all the groups that I met with last week, and there were quite a few of them. And I know they're hard to read, but there's a League of Conservation Voters. There's a whole of the Black Car Association. From every issue that you can imagine, Julia, the 4-H Club, New York State Council Superintendents, unions, on and on and on and on. And that's a day in the life in Albany, and it goes by pretty quickly.
Yeah. So, especially right now with budget time, right?
Well, and 10 o'clock comes, you want to go home and you want to go to sleep. But then you're so wound up you can't sleep until 1 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you so much for sharing your day with us and coming in today.
Great to be with you. Hope we can talk about this again.
Great. Great.
Thanks.
For any additional information, you could log on to the Senator's website, tomlibous.com.